गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स. टुडे इन पेडागॉजी ऑफ बायोलॉजिकल एंड फिजिकल साइंसेस वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट यूनिट 8. द टाइटल ऑफ यूनिट 8 इज कम्युनिटी रिसोर्सेज एंड लैबोरेटरी. सो इन दिस यूनिट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस व्हाट आर द वेरियस कम्युनिटी रिसोर्सेज एंड लैबोरेटरी रिसोर्सेज, हाउ इफेक्टिवली वी कैन यूज इन ऑर्डर टू फैसिलिटेट द टीचिंग लर्निंग इन द क्लासरूम. Okay, so in that the 8.1 unit is learning sources from immediate environment. Okay, so what are the different learning resources we have in our immediate environment, means our surroundings areas, so that we can give those examples or we can use those resources in order to teach the different science concepts. So let us discuss about this subunit. So the physical environment includes physical, natural and socio-cultural world. See, whatever environment we are having in our surroundings, that consists of physical environment means the materialistic, natural means which is existed naturally, and socio-cultural world means society and the community comes under socio-cultural. So the environment is, if we divide the environment into three types, that is physical environment, natural and socio-cultural. So learners find acquired knowledge significant if learning of science takes place from the primary context of their immediate environment. Okay, so students feel interest and important if the examples or resources you are using from your immediate environment, because they are aware about those things and they are daily seeing those things. So if you use such resources for your teaching learning process, they feel interesting as well as important, significant. So teachers of biological and physical science should appreciate that the environment around the student is full of learning opportunities. Okay, so the teacher, so see, for this the teacher should be creative. He should not think that for this topic or for this concept we cannot give any example. You must think, you must use your creativity and innovativeness. Like if it is a dry topic also, you can produce any some productive or experimental thing from that. So that is there in the hands of a teacher. For that purpose he need to be a creative and innovative. So here the teacher brings various resources from his environment and community resources for making the classes more interesting. For example, on the school ground, certain things are almost always available, okay, such as soil, plants, trees, insects, birds, sunshine and shadows, bicycles and automobiles. So these all things are easily available in our surroundings. So the teacher has to think which is useful for our teaching learning process. Okay, and almost all these things are useful whenever the necessary or required topic is ongoing in the classroom. So the teacher must think that whenever he is teaching some particular concept, he must relate, okay, with the resources which are easily available in his surroundings, okay, like soil, plants, trees, insect, birds, sunshine and shadows, even bicycles and automobiles. These are easily available in our surroundings, so you must relate with these things in your teaching learning concepts, and you have to use these resources whenever they are required. A range of activities can be organized from these things, situations and materials. Students can measure difference in the temperature. See, for example, here I am giving the example of temperature. So students can measure difference in the temperature in the sun and the shade using a laboratory thermometer. Okay, so here by this they can understand how to measure the temperature, what are the different scales of temperature, okay, Fahrenheit and degrees Celsius. So sun, and they understood that sun is the source of energy, because in shadow the temperature will be fall down, okay, whenever they come in the sunshine, okay, the temperature will be rises. So like this they can understand three concepts here: the Fahrenheit scale, Celsius scale, as well as sun is the source of energy. So like that, with the basic minimal resources which are easily available in our surroundings, we can teach the concepts to the students. That is only the community and resources and immediate environment which are easily available in our surroundings. From that you have to use the resources and teach. Students can observe how plants are growing in their school ground in a given time interval. Okay, they may observe the life cycle of butterfly in their school premises or in the nature. Okay, because if there are plants in the school, okay, you can observe so many insects and life cycles of the insects easily. Okay, because they lay their eggs on the leaves. Okay, they stay, they fly over the trees. So by that we can observe some things in our school garden and in our surroundings. And they may observe different animals and their habitats. Okay, how bird forms the nest. Okay, how the what are the different behaviors and patterns of the animals. You can observe if you have some resources in your surroundings. And in fact, many learning opportunities are available in the school ground. Okay, classroom, kitchen, bathroom, markets, on the roads itself. These all are the resources for learning. Okay, like on the ground you are having the soil. Okay, you can measure the length of the ground in the classroom. Okay, you can conduct any activity in the classroom. Then kitchen, okay, in kitchen so many ingredients are there, for example, for acids, bases and other things. Okay, in bathroom, for bathroom you can use the for example of organisms, growing organisms in the moist places such as fungus. Okay, and markets and on the roads, these all things are useful whenever it is required, whenever you can want to relate with your topics and concept. So these all are come under the immediate environment. And outside the classroom, experiences of the learners can be used in teaching learning of science to provide them first-hand experience. So our aim is to provide first-hand experience. It is whatever resources you are using, but the students should get first-hand experiences from those resources. So that is the main intention of teaching science here. So if there is no availability, you can use this immediate environment. Okay, and make this is a priority list in your teaching learning process so that the students feel interesting and important because they are aware about this immediate environment. And learners should construct and reconstruct their knowledge. Okay, so construction and reconstruction. If they don't know about the topic anything, so they construct the new knowledge. Okay, if they already know about that concept, okay, maybe they the proper knowledge is not there about that concept, or naive conception or misconceptions are there about that concept, that will be reconstructed after teaching. So like that, learners should construct and reconstruct their knowledge from observing, classifying, categorizing, questioning, reasoning, arguing and interacting with the natural world and people around them. So by doing all these things in the immediate environment, they understand the concept by reconstructing and reconstructing. A science teacher should think on the line of flexibility, conceptuality and plurality in designing curricular experiences. Okay, so flexibility should be there. Okay, there is no rigid timetable or rigid strategies or approaches should not be followed for teaching. Flexibility should be there for the convenience of the student. Conceptuality should be there. Okay, so concept should be understood by teaching those things or by using those resources. And plurality in designing curricular experiences means variety of experiences you should give. You should not go only in one way, monotonous way. You use various types of experiences in plural. Plurality means different types of experiences you have to give to the students. Next, you see a number of carry-home activities can be identified as an extension of classroom activity. Many such activities can be suggested, such as, see, you can give so many activities to the students because here we are using immediate environment. So there are so many resources in the home and surroundings from which students can learn the concepts. So there are some examples. For example, if you are teaching a natural pH, for example, you are teaching pH concepts in the class. Okay, what is pH? pH stands for potential of hydrogen and it refers the hydrogen ion concentration in a solution. So that is the pH. So whenever you are teaching pH, you give some examples to the students that how they can observe the pH in their surroundings in their home. Okay, like it is a measure of the acidity or alkalinity of a solution, and the pH values ranges from 0 to 14 on a pH scale. So these all description you will give in the class. Now ask them to observe some pH indicators in their surroundings or immediate environment. For example, here beets. Okay, so here beets and blackberries, grapes, grape juice, okay, like plums, turnip skin, and more all act as an edible natural pH indicators. These we use in our home, okay, in our food items, like these beetroots, blackberries, grape juices, these all are used as a natural indicator. They all have one pigment called as anthocyanin. So in them, which makes the solution change color, but they also differ in that little side group attached. Okay, they all change their color, but in the chemical composition they differ. So this also you can give as a natural example. Then turmeric also a natural example. Okay, it's a natural pH indicator. This means it changes color depending on the its pH exposure. For example, when we use this curcumin means it's the scientific name of the turmeric, curcuma longa we said. So here when curcumin is exposed to a basic substance, what happened, a substance or solution, whenever it exposes, it changes color from yellow to a deep red. Okay, see, you might have observed whenever we are cooking, okay, when we add this turmeric to the our food item, so what happened, it changes to color from yellow to a deep red. So this is like a pH indicator we can use in the our immediate environment as a natural pH indicator. So teacher can suggest these examples, beets and turmeric, even color change lipstick also, that is nowadays we are using in the cosmetics, color change lipsticks. In this, the ingredient that allows this lipstick to change color is called as red 27. Okay, we use the ingredient in color change lipstick is red 27. So this red 27 is clear when dissolves in the lipstick tube, but reacts with your lips moisture and pH level to adjust color. Okay, so it color red 27 is the ingredient we use in this color change lipstick, but it's clear when it dissolved in the lipstick tube, but when reacts with the with your lips. Okay, so it's based upon the your moisture of lips, because you exposed to the different kind of environment and humidity and temperature, so that time it changes its colors. So your lips moisture and pH level to adjust the color. So that is the color change lipstick. Here the main thing, substance we use in this is red 27. So like this, these are examples for the natural pH indicators we can give students so that they can observe and analyze in their surroundings and immediate environment. And one more thing, soap and detergent also we can give example. Like a soap is the metal salt of fatty acid, so the metal may be in alkali metal, such as see, sodium and potassium are the alkali metal, and we find these metals in the first column of periodic table of the elements. Okay, and other metals such as calcium and magnesium also we use in soap and detergents. These metals are found in the second column of the periodic table of the element. So whenever you are teaching about these elements, whenever you are teaching about the soaps and detergent, whenever you are teaching about the periodic table, you can relate all these things. Okay, like where you find these things, okay, what is the nature, what purpose we use these things. Okay, in daily we are using these alkali metals in our soap and detergent, so that they feel familiar and they can understand easily. And a fatty acid, what is fatty acid? Fatty acid is a organic compound, most often of an animal or plant origin. Okay, these are from either from animal or from plant sources we can collect these fatty acids, and they contain the carbon, hydrogen and oxygen molecules, and they are a long aliphatic chain. What is aliphatic chain? Compound is aliphatic is a compound, is an organic compound containing carbon and hydrogen joined together. A straight chain is called as aliphatic carbon skeleton with carboxylic acid group. So fatty acid at the end, it consists of a carboxylic acid group. An example for this is a soap is a potassium palmitate. We can scientifically we can call the soap is a potassium palmitate, and this is the formula of potassium palminate. So like this, whenever you come across such concepts in the class, like soap, the minerals, whatever minerals or elements present in the soap, you give examples. Okay, don't teach elements as a separate. And though if you do not give example of soap and detergent, they do not understand very well. When you related elements with the soap and detergent, what happened? They feel familiar. Oh, whatever we are using daily in our home, in that these all elements are present. Like that, they feel familiar and they can easily remember the concepts. Then detergent also. So for detergent, we have some. See here, in detergents, we mostly use. They are often the synthetic origin. They are man-made, and they are not made insoluble by mineralized or hard water. So they are not insoluble. And also, instead of carboxylic acid group, a detergent contains a more highly ionic group. Okay, so apart from carboxylic group, it also contains an ionic group. What are they? Sulfate and sulfonate groups. These are present. So whenever you are discussing about sulfurs, discuss about the detergent. Okay, so a detergent is a sodium lauryl sulfate. In detergent, which form of sulfur is present? Sodium lauryl sulfate is present. So like this, relate the concepts with the daily life and immediate environment sources and examples, so that they can understand the concepts easily. Then baking soda. Baking soda is the chemical compound of sodium bicarbonate. Okay, we call the baking soda as a sodium carbonate, and the formula is NaHCO3. So it is a salt composed of sodium ions and bicarbonate ions. So we call it as sodium bicarbonate. So sodium bicarbonate is a white solid that is crystalline but often appears as a fine powder, because we make it into the fine powder for our use. So it is available in the crystal form, okay, but often appears as a fine powder. So this is used for cooking, cleaning and toothpaste. So whenever you are teaching about sodium bicarbonate in your chemical reactions, give example of this. See, in cooking, cleaning and toothpaste, we use this baking soda to clean the things. And washing soda also. Washing soda is the chemical compound and of a sodium carbonate is this name. Okay, so the formula is Na2CO3. It is the water soluble salt of carbonic acid, and it occurs most commonly as a crystalline decahydrate, so which readily effloresces. Okay, what is the meaning of effloresces? Okay, effloresces is nothing but migration of a salt to the surface of a porous material. Okay, migration of a salt to the surface of a porous material where it forms a coating. Okay, sometimes we see the appearance of salt on some surfaces, that is called efflorescence. Okay, so efflorescence to form a white powder, the monohydrate. So washing soda exhibit the characteristic of efflorescence. Okay, the formula is Na2CO3, and washing soda that can be used to remove stubborn stains from the laundry. Okay, we use this in our laundry purpose. Okay, to remove the stubborn stains. Okay, and one more example is common salt, that is we use for the concentration and solubility, etc. So see, these are the basic examples: baking soda, washing soda, common salt. Whenever you are teaching about the basis, okay, acids bases, give these examples for the basis. Okay, and they can daily observe these chemical compounds in their home, their purposes, their uses, their chemical combination they can understand, their formulas they can easily remember, because they are daily observing these things in their immediate environment. Next, fiber. Okay, so fiber is a thread or filament from which vegetable tissue or mineral substance or textile is formed. Okay, so whenever we are discussing about the threads, okay, the synthetic fibers, natural fibers, discuss about the fibers. Okay, where they are available, from where we extract. Okay, give examples of our immediate surroundings, like dietary material contains substances, means the vegetables whatever we eat, in that the cellulose, lignin and pectin will be there, and these are resistant to action of digestive enzymes. Our digestive system cannot digest these things. Okay, it can help to prevent heart diseases and diabetes, and also stop the weight gain. Okay, so fiber can lower blood sugar, cut the cholesterol and prevent colon cancer. Okay, so these are the uses of fiber. They by with the help of fiber we are making the threads. Okay, as well as if we eat those fibers in the form of vegetables, that is very helpful for our health. They stop weight gain. Okay, they reduce that the heart diseases and the diabetes, and they lower the blood sugar, cut the cholesterol, and prevent the colon cancer. So such type of example you have to give so that they can relate the teaching with their daily life. Next, pulleys. Okay, so what is pulleys? Pulleys is we discuss in the physical sciences. So a wheel with a grooved rim around which cord passes, which acts as a change the direction of a force applied, that is called pulleys. Okay, so we generally we see these pulleys in our daily routine. For example, generators, washing machines, everything which is which consists of a wheel with a grooved rim around which a cord passes, so that comes under pulleys. So ask the students, give examples to pulleys, and ask name the machines or the things which they observe daily in their daily life for pulleys. Ask them to give exams for pulleys. So like this, they can we can relate it with our immediate environment. Even projectiles also. What are projectiles? Projectiles are nothing but an object propelled through the air, especially thrown in as a weapon. Okay, so when you use these things, when you for throwing into the air as a weapon, for example, shuttlecock, badminton ball, long jump athletes, golf ball and basketball, we use these things as a projectiles. Okay, these are propelled through air, especially one thrown in as a weapon in the air. So for that, you can give all these things as a examples whenever you are teaching about these things. Lenses and mirrors. Okay, for example, there are convex lenses and concave lenses. Okay, so for that, give examples like driver side mirror in vehicle. Okay, so in that we use the convex lens because driver has to see the things. Okay, in that, like, it because convex lens shows the things in smaller and more image can fit into the mirror and provides larger field of view in that mirror. So that's the reason we use convex lens in the driver mirror. Okay, and even in the camera also we use that. And in sunglasses we use polycarbonic lenses. Okay, polycarbonate lenses, because these polycarbonate lenses are less in weight, so that is the reason we use the polycarbonate lenses in sunglasses. Okay, in projectors we use convex lenses because in projector we have to magnify the content. Okay, so here also we use the convex lenses. Like, give daily life examples so that they can understand the concept very clear. And like that, only for concave lenses you can give examples of binoculars, telescopes, eyeglasses, okay, flashlights, even lasers, CDs and DVD players. Okay, all comes under concave lenses. So like this, you can give the examples from your immediate environment. And filters like cotton, wool, jute. Okay, these papers use for the filtering the substances. Even in our lab also we use to separate the substances. Okay, and even interconversion of one form of energy to other form, like all machines around us. Okay, like they are converting electrical energy to mechanical energy. Okay, physical to chemical. Like that, you can give interconversion of one form of energy to other forms. And propagation of waves in solids, liquids and gases, like ripples water in water tank and reservoir, etc. You can show the how waves forms, light waves forms in the water. It appears in the form of ripples because of wind. Okay, and list of some of the changes taking place around you, like physical and chemical changes. Like you can give example of evaporation, condensation, sublimation. Okay, these examples you can give, which you can easily observe in your natural surroundings. Okay, then list of acids and bases also you can give from your surroundings. Like, for example, you can give example of acids, citric acid from the citrus fruits, lemon, orange and all. Then from vinegar we use in the home, like vinegar consists of most of the vinegar consists of the acetic acid, but little amount of citric and tartaric acid also present in the vinegar. Okay, like that, give some examples from your immediate environment. For bases, you can give baking soda, diluted soaps, household ammonia. Household ammonia is called as ammonium hydroxide. Like we use this household ammonia in as a stain remover, and what else we use for the cleaning of gold and silver things, glasses, steel, blood stains. For all these things, we use the household ammonia. This is used as a base. So give examples from the daily routine so that they can remember very well. We have so many examples for these things from our immediate environment. So teacher must use these things and locate, observe and note down examples of the lever, machines, pulleys, gears used in our daily life. Ask the students to give daily life examples for these things and list the things at home which are good or bad conductors of heat and electricity, such as water, wood, metal. Okay, so many things are there which conducts the electricity, and make measurements, length, volume, area of some solids and liquid. Okay, take them to the ground, okay, school ground, ask them to measure the length, okay, volume, area, and even in the class also they can measure, ask them to measure the blackboard, okay, length, and their benches, everything. There are so many resources available so that you can teach the concepts very easily. Then food chain, linkages of organisms within an ecosystem, in which we know what is food chain. Okay, linkage between between the organisms by which they depend on each other, being the relationship eating and eaten up. Okay, so that is the food chain. You can show the food chain in our environment, like how organisms are depending. Okay, like grass is, give example of grass. Okay, and that cow is feeding. Okay, like that you can show so many food chains. Okay, you can also give as a grasshopper. Okay, grasshopper and frog. Okay, like that so many examples are there. You can relate with the natural surroundings and immediate environment. And human beings are at the top of the food chain ever since mastering the creation and use of tools in which to hunt and defend themselves from predators. So like that, how they are defending from each other, you can give examples from the immediate surroundings. Even we have medicinal plants. Okay, so here see, we extract aspirin. Okay, aspirin is a medicine from willow bark. Okay, willow bark is a plant. It is from Salix species. So aspirin, the medicine is extracted from this willow bark or Salix. So this aspirin is used for pain reliever or for minor aches. Okay, reduce fever, blood thinner, use as a blood thinner also. This heart attack also we are using aspirin. So like this, from willow bark we are extracting this aspirin, and it is having a very good medicinal usages. Like even for heart attack also we are using aspirin, for even for blood, as a blood thinner, and small as fever and pains also we are using. Okay, then digital is also from flax glove plant. Okay, the scientific name of the plant is digitalis purpursor. Okay, so digitalis is a chemical substance we extract from this flax glove plant. This is used for the treatment of heart diseases. Okay, then vinblastin from Madagascar periwinkle, or also generally we call it as Vinca rosea, for the treatment of childhood leukemia. Even for cancer also we use leukemia, also one of the cancer. So what is this leukemia? Leukemia is nothing but increased number of immature or abnormal leukocytes in the blood, and these immature and abnormal leukocytes inhibit the growth of other normal blood cells. So this is the leukemia. In this situation we use this vinblastin is extracted from the Madagascar periwinkle or Vinca rosea plant. And also some more medicinal plants are called as Karingali. Okay, in common name is Karingali, scientific name is Acacia catechu. So Karingali is useful for control the blood sugar. Okay, then Karalakam also one more plant which is available in our surroundings, and its scientific name is Aristolochia indica. Okay, indica, because it is available in the, first they found in India, that's the reason they keep its name as India. It's a species name, Aristolochia indica. So this is useful for fever, digestive system disorders. We use this Karalakam tree extractions. And Batamari scientific name is Asparagus resinosus. So this Batamari is useful for cough, fever, fever, pain, and other some gastrointestinal problems and disorders, we use Bhatamari extractions. And Menthoni, okay, Menthoni scientific name is Gloriosa superba. So this Menthoni is useful for, its juice is very famous. The Menthoni plant juice used for anti-malarial drug, okay, and used for chronic ulcers and cancers also, treatment of the cancers, we use this Menthoni. So like this, these all are certain medicinal plants which are available in our surroundings in the immediate environment. Give these examples, okay, whenever you are teaching about different diseases and different drugs, give these examples so that they can study about these plants, they can identify these plants, and they can explain and they can use the medicinal purposes of these plants in their daily life. Then coming to the fisheries, okay, so whenever you are discussing about the fishes and aquaculture, you can discuss about the fisheries. Like a fishery is an entity engaged in raising or harvesting fish, which is determined by some authority to be a fishery. So it's a department, so it is useful for the growing of fishes, okay, for the purpose of food production. Okay, so this you can give example how they are maintaining, okay, what are the different ponds, okay, in which they grow the fishes. So then forestry is the science and craft of creating, managing, using, conservating and repairing forest and associated resources to meet desired goals, needs and values for human environment benefits. Forestry is practiced in plantations and natural stands. Okay, whenever you are discussing natural resources, okay, plants, wildlife, you can give example of the forestry and forest sources, how they grow, how they developed, how they spread, okay, how they are playing their role in the biodiversity, everything you can give example. These are all things are available, okay, and the students may have some knowledge about these things. So give examples from these things, so for better conceptual understanding. What is the need of studying this concept in our pedagogy is, whenever you give simple and basic examples to the students, they understand the concepts very well, because they know that example, they are aware of that example, and they have seen, they are in touch with that example in their daily life. So if whenever you give such examples, they feel familiar and they understand very well. So that is the main reason of using immediate resources or immediate environment for teaching learning of physical and biological concepts. Okay, thank you.